Amen. God, you are good. And all the time. And whoever finds Jesus, finds life, absolutely. Well, my name is Jeff, and I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope. And great to see everyone this morning. And I do want you to know that if you're visiting today, I don't believe it's an accident that you're here. I believe that every person who comes through these doors, God brings for a purpose. And today He wants to speak some truth into your life and some love into your life. And I'm honored to be a small piece of that this morning. If you are visiting, it's not going to take you long to figure out that we're not a perfect church. And that's because we're full of imperfect people like me and my brother Mike up here. But we're real serious about sharing Christ's love with people so that He can step in and transform their broken lives and our broken lives in the process. So if you're visiting today, let us know that you're here. There's a communication card in your bulletin. It looks like this. And if you would, fill it out, and at the end of the worship hour, take it to the Welcome Center out back and exchange that with us. We have a free gift we'd love to give you, and we'd love to have a chance to connect with you that way. So please let us know that you're here today. Well, one thing I want to always encourage you to do is to look on the back page of the bulletin for announcements so you know what's going on and how you can be connected and involved in New Hope. One of the things I want to point out is September 18th, Sunday, September 18th, we will be doing our next baptisms and child dedications following the second worship hour at around 12:30, give or take a few. And so if you have never been baptized, immersed into Christ of your own decision to follow Christ, I want to encourage you to make that commitment. If you'd like to dedicate a child to the Lord, I would encourage you to make that commitment as well. So if you'd like to be baptized or dedicate a child, just put your name, phone number, email address on your communication card, and then drop it in one of the tithe and offering boxes by the doors here in the worship center. And I will call you the week before. Just make sure you're ready to go for that. So I want to encourage you, if you've never done that, to take that opportunity and do that. Well, I'm excited because last week I launched a brand new series that I've entitled, He's Coming Back. And this series really is all about what Jesus did just before He was crucified, buried, and resurrected. He told His disciples that He would one day return and He would judge the world and He would take those who are His with Him back to heaven. Now, what we're going to do, what we started last week and what we're doing over the next few weeks, is we are looking at Jesus' specific words about this, the red letters, as He wrote in Matthew chapter 24 and 25, as He spoke specifically about His return to this world, and what that will be about and what we should expect. And so we're just going through verse by verse, Matthew 24 and 25, and looking at what Jesus says about His own return. Now, last week, message I've titled Standing Firm, and I talked about the importance of standing firm in Jesus for when He returns. And today I want to talk about, well, next week I want to talk about working faithfully for Jesus when He returns. Today I want to talk about being ready for when Jesus returns. So if you want to look on the screen here this morning, and I want us to repeat our key verse for this series, which is Matthew 24, 44. This is Jesus speaking. Again, this is the red letter part of your Bible if you have a red letter version. So let's all say it together big and loud. I hope we're memorizing this throughout this series because it's a very important truth from Christ. Ready? Here we go. Matthew 24, 44. Everyone. So you must be ready, because the Son of Man, Jesus, will come at an hour when you do not expect Him. Now, I shared with you last week that for my wife and I's anniversary last week, one of the things that we did was we went to Sam's Club and spent a day shopping together, and which is what you should always do for your anniversary. And while we were shopping through Sam's, we got into the frozen section, which is my favorite section of Sam's. And the reason that it's my favorite section is because there's this one section that has, you guessed it, ice cream. And so we're walking through there, and I just happened to look over, and I saw there like a little angel. These are such a wonderful creation from the Lord. They're these little waffle cones with vanilla ice cream and chocolate and nuts embedded into the chocolate. You know, those are like little angel gifts from the Lord. And I walked by, and I saw those, and it just took me into a trance. And I had visions of drumsticks dancing in my head. And I was certain that I was only there a few seconds dreaming of these drumsticks. There was a pack of 48. That'd last me for a couple days. And, you know, it was wonderful. And I was just, I was having these visions, and it was so, and I look up, and my wife, Julie, she's gone. Now, the crazy thing about it was we were in the frozen section, and it's a big section, and we're in the middle. And I'm going, okay, she snuck down the other aisle. So I look over, okay, no, Julie. I run over to the, no, Julie, this is not good. I go to the far side of the frozen section. She's not there. I run all the way around the frozen section once. I can't find her. I go twice. I'm on my third time around, and I'm thinking, I knew she was closer to Jesus than I was. He came back, and I'm the one left here all alone. And it kind of freaked me out for a moment, because I'm going, there's no way she could have got away that quickly. And then as I'm looking, there she is in the salad section over there, and I said, thank you, Jesus. You didn't come yet, and I didn't miss the ride, and I'm glad I didn't miss you. Now, I tell you that because it's kind of funny, but the reality is Jesus is going to come back one day, and he's going to take those who are his. Amen. Now, my question for you is this. As you think about your life and your past, I'm curious, how many of you have ever been in a situation where you were either left behind or you were afraid that if Christ came back, you might actually be left behind? I'm curious. Anyone ever had an experience like that or had fear of that? Well, that's most of us. Wow. I really thought I might be the only one raising my hand there, and that'd be kind of weird. But hey, if it happens, it happens. I'm the weird one. Which don't take you long to figure out. I am the weird one. So, but we're all weird. Okay. Here's the deal. Jesus is going to come back. We need to be ready. One point for the message today. If you're taking notes, you can fill in the blanks here in your bulletin. Here it is. We don't know when the Lord Jesus will return. So we better be ready and be living for him. So, don't take my word for it. Let's take Jesus' word for it. We're going to let Jesus be our guest preacher today. Are you cool with that?
Amen.
So these are his words. I'm just going to re-preach his sermon. It's really good. It's very convicting and eye-opening. But we're going to let him preach today. So Jesus, have your way and speak. These are your words. You spoke them there. Speak them again through me, and may you get the glory, honor, and credit. We welcome you as our guest preacher today. Amen. Okay. Matthew chapter 24, if you have your Bibles, turn open there this morning. We're just continuing on. We started in verse 1 last week. We're just going down through. We're in verse 36 today. And we'll go Matthew 24, 36 to 51, and then we'll pick up a little bit in Matthew 25 as well as we're continuing through this over the next few weeks. So, Matthew chapter 24, starting with verse 36, Jesus speaking about his own return. He says, but about that day, or hour, how many people know? He says, no one knows. Now check out how many people don't know. Not even the angels in heaven, which God reveals to them quite a few things since they're on mission for him. Nor who? The Son. This is Jesus speaking about himself. He says, I don't even know the day or hour. I find that fascinating. But only who?
The Father.
Father. Now, I've been on this planet. We got to stop here because we got to talk about this. I've been on this planet for 42, going on 43 years. I know I don't look like it, but I have been. Now, in those years, I have been amazed at the number of times that I have heard people predict after their detailed study of prophecy the day Jesus is coming back. I've been amazed. I mean, I've heard, every year I hear more, And I've been on this earth for 42 years, and every single one of them has been wrong. Now, I'm not saying that we be disrespectful to those who have studied prophecy and believe that they have focused in on dates or this, that, or the other, but I am going to say this. I find it incredibly strange that we human beings believe or think, some of us, that we can actually pinpoint the day and hour of the return of Jesus when Jesus, who created us himself, doesn't know. I find it incredibly awkward that a human being thinks that they are going to get more insight into this than Jesus himself. Friends, that's not going to happen. Now, why does Jesus tell us this? I think he's got a point to make. His point is this. Don't be concerned so much about determining the exact day and hour. Be concerned about making sure you're ready when I come for you. Amen. Period. I think that's his point. And let's let him say it, because that's what he's fixing to tell us here. It's better from his mouth than my mouth. Here's what he says, verse 37. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating, drinking, marrying, being given in marriage, up to the day that Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing of what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Now, Jesus uses this title, Son of Man, he refers to himself, and he also uses the title Son of God. He's the only one that can use both of those titles. But in this case, he says, so when I return, it's going to be just like the days of Noah. No one's going to be ready, and then here I'm going to come. Verse 40, here's what it'll be like, he says. Two men will be in the field. One will be taken, and the other left. Two women will be grinding in a handmill. One will be taken, and the other left. Years ago, there was a book written about this passage. Anyone know the name? Left Behind. The book became very popular and was made into several movies. There have been a bunch of Left Behind movies. Some of them were a little cheesy. Some of them are really, really cool. But the point behind those movies is phenomenal, because the idea is just simply this. Jesus is coming back. Are you ready? And you literally see people driving vehicles, and the movies, they just disappear, and the vehicle just keeps going, you know? Stuff like that's really going to happen when Christ comes back, because Jesus said they're going to vanish with Christ. He's going to take them up into the sky with him. Those movies were powerful in a lot of people's lives. The book was powerful in a lot of people's lives, and I shared with you several months ago that when I... You know, like 20-some years ago, I was leading a little youth group, and I showed one of the Left Behind movies, and the kids in my youth group after that, several of them just weeping, said, I'm not ready. Like, if Jesus comes, I'm not ready. And they were so taken by the truth and the reality that Christ is going to come back for those who are his, that they gave their hearts to him. Like everyone in my youth group that wasn't a follower of Christ asked Christ in their life that night. Amen. My question to you is this. Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Mercy. The way, the truth, the life. that there is no one that comes to the Father except through Him. If you believe that, then you have to believe His words.
Hallelujah.
Right here to you and me right now. He's coming back.
Amen.
And He's going to take those who are His.
Amen.
We have to be ready. Verse 42. Therefore, Jesus says, since this is going to happen, one's going to be taken, the other left. Since this is going to happen, therefore, keep what? Keep watch, friends. Because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known at what time the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. Jesus says, so you, speaking to you and me, if we're a follower of Christ, must be what?
Ready.
Be ready. Because the Son of Man, Jesus says, I will come in an hour when you do not expect Him. I shared with you last week as well. One of my favorite all-time movies was Joe Dirt. And we just have way too much in common. I used to have a long mullet and hairdo, and he had one of those. And I had a 1970 Plymouth Roadrunner, and he drove a 1970 Superbird, which was my car with a nose cone and a big wing on the back. So we were like connected there. But he made this statement several times throughout the movie, and it really threw me back. And the statement was this. My mama always said, is this where you want to be when Jesus comes back? Is this what you want to be found doing when Jesus comes back? And I thought, wow, what a deep truth in a movie that was really kind of poking fun of the idea. Because the reality is, He's coming back. Is this where we want to be? Is this what we want to be doing when He comes back? Are we ready? He says, be ready, because I'm coming. So, Jesus asks us the same question, verse 45. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? Now, real quick before we move on, the master is Jesus. If you've chosen to follow Him, you are His servant. So notice the master gives some responsibilities to the servant, and watch what happens next. Verse 46, it will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so, doing good, when he returns. Verse 47. Truly I tell you, he will put him in charge of what? All of his possessions. Now, I want to be this guy. Okay? Do you want to be this guy? You want to be this lady? That when Jesus returns, he's found that you have taken everything he's entrusted to you. The resources, the finances, the talents, the abilities, even the people he's placed around you, and you have used them, treated them, done with them what the Lord wanted you to do with them. You've loved people. You've forgiven people. You've pointed people to Jesus. You've used the resources that he placed in your hands because they were his, not yours. You used them for him, not for you. I mean, yeah, but you used all of them in a way that honored him. All of them, 100%. That your life was about his stuff. I want to be that guy. So when he comes, he says, listen, you've been faithful with a few things. I'm going to put you in charge of many.
Amen.
Let me tell you who I don't want to be. The next guy Jesus talks about. Here's the next guy. Verse 48. But suppose that servant is wicked and says to himself, My master is staying away a long time, a.k.a. Jesus hadn't come back yet. He's probably not going to come back in my lifetime. I'm going to wait till my deathbed. I'm going to live however I want to until then, and then I'll claim the cross, and I'll receive the forgiveness, and I'll get my free ticket to heaven. Is that possible? Yeah, that was a false version, wasn't it, Joe? Here's the deal. Can a person truly give their heart to Christ on their deathbed? Yes. The thief on the cross did that. It can happen. Can a person, though, knowing what Christ did on the cross, choose to live a life to not follow him, and then with the idea that he'll just confess on his deathbed and be fine? I say no. And here's why I say no. Because that person doesn't really want to follow Jesus anyway.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? It's not real.
Amen.
That's a fake. That's not the real deal. That person really doesn't want to follow Christ. So, no, that person's probably not going to be saved in the end, because they probably never really commit their heart to Christ at the end. Now, if they do, they will be. But I don't think they really will, because they don't want to commit their heart to Christ now. Jesus said, if you're going to follow me, you must deny yourself. Not you should, but you must. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. In other words, it's not about living for you, it's about living for me. See, I purchased you on the cross. You belong to me, you don't belong to you. So that's what happens. So we got to recognize that, and that's about truly making him the Lord of our life, not just our Savior. You know, give me your free ticket to heaven, but I'm not going to give you control of my life. Well, that's a joke. That's actually mockery to Christ, because he's Lord. He's Creator. He's Savior. He deserves to be Lord. Interestingly, notice how he refers to himself in this piece here.
He's forever.
I'm the master. You're the servant. That's the analogy in what Jesus is trying to say in this very, very words here. Okay? We got to get that. We got to live that. We got to understand that. So the wicked person says, well, you know, my master's staying away a long time, verse 49. And he then begins to beat his fellow servants, to eat and drink with drunkards. Sound like anything you've ever seen or witnessed or experienced in your life? He begins to live for himself. Verse 50. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and in an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Any idea what place that's talking about? That's talking about hell. Jesus uses this same description in other places where he makes very clear that hell is real. I am firmly convinced that one of Satan's greatest tools to keep people from following the Lord is to convince them in their minds that hell is not real. That's one of his greatest tools. Hell's not real. You live your life however you want. And if hell is real, it's a party place where we're going to party with Satan until forever. Like the forever party. So this is the lie that Satan breeds into people's minds about hell. Jesus speaks many times very clearly about the reality of hell. Weeping and gnashing of teeth. Eternal flames, eternal torment. Stop for a moment, and I want you to go somewhere in your mind with me. Go back to the last time in your life that you were weeping uncontrollably and you couldn't stop. Go there. Imagine with me the depth of the pain you were experiencing at that moment. Now, have you ever been at a point with that weeping that you were in such anguish that you felt that your end was so near, or maybe you even hoped your end was so near because you didn't want to live anymore. Your will to live was gone, and you were literally gnashing your teeth and just wishing it was over. Grinding your teeth. You been there? Imagine a place where that's all you do. Fathom that. And in pain, in torment. I've seen pictures and I've seen videos of people who have been caught on fire alive and lived through it. Flesh brutally mutilated. Their description of the experience being the most horrific, painful experience on planet Earth. Guys, I can't fathom. I cannot fathom that. I've been too close to the grill and fried the hairs on my arms. About took my eyebrows off once. But my flesh has never been on fire. And yet, Scripture, Jesus tells us, this is hell. So it's real. It's the real deal. Just as real as heaven. I don't want to be this guy who, when Jesus comes back, I'm not being a good servant of my master Christ. I want to be the guy who's being a faithful servant. We'll talk more about that next week. But bottom line is this. If Jesus were to come back today, would he find you managing his stuff and the people he's placed in your life well? Loving them well, using them well for him? Or would he find you living for yourself? Well, Jesus continues on. We go to Matthew chapter 25, the first 13 verses, 1 through 13, and he tells a story that's pretty telling. I'm just going to read it to you and share a few thoughts. Matthew 25, verse 1. At that time, he says, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom, which is a fancy word for the groom, the guy that's going to get married to the bride. Verse 2, 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. In other words, it wasn't such a big deal. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. Now the bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. Verse 6, at midnight, the cry rang out, here's the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Then all the virgins woke up, trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out. No, they replied, there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves. But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were what? Ready. What'd they do? They went in with him to the wedding banquet. And the door was shut. Later, the others also came. Lord, Lord, they said, open the door for us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. Man, this story is so telling. So here's the deal. Jesus is the groom coming for the bride. Guess who his bride is? His bride is the church. His bride is the group of people who've chosen to follow him, like we sang about in the song just a few minutes ago. Jesus is coming back for his bride. Are we ready? Now, when I met my wife, we knew each other about a year before we actually got married. We met in August. We started dating officially in October. I proposed in February. We got married in August. The summer before we got married, we were apart the whole summer. I was working for a camp team, traveling a different state every week for the whole summer at a different camp, counseling kids and pointing them to Christ and leading them to Christ and encouraging them. Man, it just, one of the neatest summers of my life. And yet, one of the hardest summers of my life. And here's why. Even while I was out here doing all this work for the Lord, I was so looking forward to that day that I would stand before God at the altar with Julie, and that I would get to commit a covenant between the Lord and my bride for life, and that we would come together, and as Scripture says, the two would become one flesh, and we would serve God's purpose together as one. I'm telling you, I dreamt about Julie. She consumed every free moment of thought. I so look forward to that day. And then I think about Jesus. And here he is, dreaming about the day that he's going to come to you if you're a follower of Christ, his bride, and take you as his own, and then take you away to the mansion that he's prepared in heaven. Whoa. And then I have to ask the question, are we ready? Am I ready? You know, Scripture paints this beautiful picture in the book of Ephesians about the return of Christ. And it parallels it with marriage. And it says that Jesus is preparing his bride, the church, to be beautiful as a bride without spot or blemish. He's purifying her. Now, if you're a follower of Christ, that's you. So this is what that means. He's purifying us. He's transforming us. He's working out, if you've chosen to follow Christ already, he's working with us to work out the salvation that he already worked inside of us the moment we chose to believe and receive him and confess him as Lord, make him the boss of our lives. So he started that movement within in our hearts, and he's working that out. And so there are things in our lives that he wants to change to make us beautiful, a bride ready for her groom to come without spot and blemish. So as you think about that, are you a bride that's ready? Where are you at in this transformation process? What needs to change? What habits need to be kicked? What addictions need to be overcome? Whether it's porn or drugs or alcohol or overeating or judgmentalism or pride or unforgiveness or greed or list goes on and on. Selfishness, self-centeredness. What stains or blemishes are there on your wedding dress? You know, at weddings, it's typical that the wife, the bride, comes with a white dress. Why is that? Anybody know? Well, the white dress is supposed to mean that this woman is pure, a virgin, to give herself to her husband and him only for the rest of her life until the day she draws her last breath. That's the symbolism. Now, none of us are perfect, but Jesus wants to purify us so that on the day of his return, we are a bride without spot or blemish. And Jesus covers all of our sin on the cross. But he loves us too much to leave us the way we currently are for the rest of our lives. He loves us the way we are, but he loves us too much to leave us that way. So, here's what I want us to do this week, okay? This is in your notes and also on the screen. Here's what I want us to do this week as a result. If Jesus returned tonight, would you be ready living for him the way you should be? If not, make a list of the changes you need to make and ask the Holy Spirit to help you start working through the list this week. That's it. Why should you do this? Let me tell you a true story. Years ago, my wife and I had a neighbor who lived just down the road from us. We had gotten to know him. He was thoroughly convinced, having done all of his prophecy study, that Jesus was going to return in 6 months. Matter of fact, he gave us the day. He was so convinced that Jesus was going to return, he quit his job. And he was so convinced that Jesus was going to return, he confessed to me that there were things in his life that had to change so he would be ready for the return of Christ. He said, "I quit smoking because I felt like I was not honoring God with that." He also confessed to me that he still struggled with one thing, that he knew God was not okay with, and he was trying so hard to stop, it was smoking marijuana. And he said, "I have not been able to beat this." And he said, "I know that if I don't beat this before Christ returns, I'm not going to be ready." Now, I'm not talking about the theological truthfulness of the statement. I'm just telling you what he said. That's what he said. Now, we could just go home now and call it a day, or, as Paul Harvey says, I'll tell you the rest of the story. Want to know the rest of the story?
Yep.
6 months comes. Jesus had not returned. Our neighbor was still smoking marijuana. Six months after that, almost to the day, he died from a heart attack. So he did, in fact, meet Jesus face to face, and it was coming really quick for him. Just not quite the way that he thought it would happen. Man, I think about his life, and I think there's a few things that we need to grasp from this. First is this. Jesus is, in fact, coming back.
Amen.
He told us it is so. Second, the Holy Spirit, if you've chosen to follow Christ, lives inside of your heart. Scripture makes very, very clear that one of the jobs of the Holy Spirit is to convict us of sin. In other words, he is to bring to our attention when we're doing something, when there's stains and blemishes on our bridal dress that don't honor him. The Holy Spirit's to convict us of those things. That's one of his jobs. So, at times in your life, the Holy Spirit will bring to your attention something that he wants to work with you to conquer and have victory over in your life, in cleaning your wedding dress in preparation.
Hallelujah.
Now, maybe you've experienced some of this in your life where you're like, okay, I really sense God telling me this is something that's got to change in my life. He's telling me it's wrong. He's telling me he wants me to change it. Now, if you're like me, when that happens, sometimes I'm like, I've tried and I fail. I can't do this. You ever been there? Here's the secret. Every time that the Holy Spirit brings to your mind or heart or spirit a conviction, in other words, this area of your life is wrong, he only does that because he is at the same time willing to give you the power that if you surrender to his control, he will lead you to victory. He will never reveal to you something he wants to beat that he's not willing to put out the effort of his Godhood, that when you surrender to him, you'll beat it with him. So know that. Don't freak out about it. Don't believe the devil's lie that, well, because I've screwed up so many times in the past and I fail and fail and fail that I'll just never be victorious. That's a lie from the enemy. There's no truth to that at all. It's a total lie.
Amen.
Jesus said, he that condemns is the devil. He said, I didn't come to condemn, but to give life. Christ came to give you life. So realize and recognize that truth. And so if there's something that the Spirit's convicting you of, surrender completely to him in that area so that he can give you victory. And if you mess up, if you trip and fall down, Scripture tells us that the wise man, though he falls seven times, rises up again.
If you mess up, fess up.
You mess up, fess up. Man, you fall down, you get back up with Jesus. He loves you. He doesn't hate you, but you work with him to overcome this. You don't just stay where you're at. And I look at our neighbor's life and I go, the Spirit convicted him, but he wasn't willing to surrender full control in that area. And I don't want to be a guy that when I die, the Spirit had convicted me about these things and I haven't surrendered control. I don't want to be that guy. I want to be the guy who's given him full control. And you know what? The third piece of that story that we need to make sure we don't miss. Jesus may come back in your lifetime. Friends, if he wants to, he could come back tonight. But I can assure you of this. If he doesn't return before the day you draw your last breath on earth, on that day, you will meet him face to face. My question to you is, are you ready for that day?
Amen.
And if not, ask him to show you what needs to change and ask him to help you do it this week. How many of you would say, you know what, Pastor, pray for me that God would show me what needs to change and that he would help me be ready for his return? If that would be you, raise your hand. Friends, I'm going to pray for all of us. But before I do, I want you to picture with me something in your mind. And that is this. What would it look like if all of us truly started living our lives to be ready for Christ when we meet him? What would happen if we started looking as expectantly towards that wedding day when our groom comes and we come to him and we meet him face to face? He's dreaming about that day, by the way. Jesus is crazy about that day. He's so looking forward to that day when he can take you. What if you looked forward to that as much as he did? What if you worked with him to clean the blemishes on your dress? And as the world that is black, covered with sin and hopelessness, looks at you and they see this brilliance shining inside of you and they go, what is the deal with you? Why are you at peace when the world's in chaos? Why? What is this light in you? And how are you changing? And you say, Jesus is transforming my life.
Amen.
And they see Jesus in you instead of you in you. And you know what happens as a result of that?
Amen.
Lost people who didn't even know there was a wedding day with Jesus coming, who didn't know there was a day of return and a day of judgment coming, find out through your own mouth the reality of what will one day happen.
Amen.
And they have opportunity to put their hope in Christ, and they have opportunity to be prepared for His return, and they have opportunity to go to heaven with Him.
Sorry, Jeff,
friends,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now, friends, I don't know about you.
Amen.
But I want to be a part of a church like that where we let Christ clean our wedding dress and we let His brilliance shine and we share His love with broken people so they can come to know Him and be transformed by His love. Anybody with me? All of us together for Jesus, whatever it takes. Let's pray. Jesus, we are so thankful for Your words of truth. And that in Your word You left for us these words about Your return. And that You are looking longingly, expectantly to the day that we meet You face to face. Lord Jesus, we confess that we got some dirt on our wedding dress. Lord Jesus, show us the areas in our life that You want to change. And Lord Jesus, help us as we surrender to You right now and this week to give You lordship, control over these areas of our lives. And Jesus, lead us to victory, not so that we can brag about how good we are, but so that we can tell others about how good and awesome You are.
Amen. Thank You, Father.
So that others may come to know You as their Savior and their Lord and their groom, who wants to take them home to heaven. Father, this is our prayer. Help us by Your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, I want to put a prayer on the screen right now. And if you are here, and if you are not yet a follower of Christ, I am so glad that you are here right now. Because the reality is this. The God who created you, the Jesus who breathed your very life into existence, is going to return one day. And He's going to take those who are His with Him to heaven. Where the Bible tells us where Jesus is, there's no more weeping or sorrow or crying or pain when we're in God's presence forever. Total peace. And Jesus wants to take you there. But He's a perfect gentleman. He will never force your hand. But He will lead you with love. And He reaches out to you right now. And He pours His heart in love to you. Scripture tells us we all deserve to go to hell because we've sinned, we've disobeyed God, we've rebelled against Him, we've gone our own way. But that He loves us so much, He came to earth in flesh in Jesus and died on that cross in your place and mine. He took the punishment we deserve in His own body on the cross. He died in our place. They buried Him in a tomb. And 3 days later, God raised Him from the dead. And He appeared to His followers and said, "Share my love with this broken world so they will come to know me." And then He ascended right before their eyes into the clouds of heaven. And from heaven today, He reaches out with His hand, His arm of love, to your heart. And he says, would you say yes to me? Would you receive my love and let me step in and begin to transform your broken life? Friends, if your prayer today would be, maybe for the very first time ever, maybe for as a serious recommitment to Christ, you were there and you fell back, but if your prayer today would be simple, Jesus, I've sinned, I've disobeyed, I believe you died for all of my disobedience, and I believe you're buried, you rose, you live today, and I give you control of my life, and I want to serve you till the day I die. Friends, if that would be your prayer today, would you just be bold right now and raise your hand and say, that's me. First time or serious recommitment, that's me. Praise the Lord. Listen, friends, if you just raised your hand, or even if you didn't, but you'd like to commit or seriously recommit to Christ today, I'd like to meet you to the left of the cross there by the door during this time, and I'd love to encourage you. I'd love to pray with you. Let's stand. We're going to worship the Lord today because Jesus is coming back, friends. We're going to worship the Lord today, and He's looking forward to that day. And as we worship the Lord, I want to thank you for investing what He's given you into His mission of transforming broken lives through His love. And so we have tithe and offering boxes by the doors. Give as an act of worship into Christ's kingdom and His mission. You can also give online, godhope.cc. But let's worship the Lord together. And again, if you want to commit or recommit your heart to Christ, just meet me to the left of the door, left of the cross with the light on right there during this time. Let's worship the Lord.